All right, I'm going to go ahead and get started because I know that Judith has a lot to do for us and with us today. Just wanted to quickly introduce myself. My name is Sarah Reif, and I am the chair of CLA's Health and Wellness Committee. Our committee has been alive and going strong for about a year now. And I strongly encourage all of you to check out our resources on our webpage. We are so thankful to have Judith Gordon here with us today. And as you may have seen from her little teaser that Layla from our Health and Wellness Committee, who is on today, did for us, she is going to present to us on how to thrive in law and avoid burnout. And I know given the past year that we have all had, I have been continually looking for tools and strategies to lessen stress and optimize my output. And I know Judith is going to provide hands-on tools and strategies for us today. So thank you, Judith. I'm very excited to have you present to us for the next hour.
Let's dive in. So let's start with a couple of principles. I've already said this is going to be interactive because passive consumption isn't learning, right? We retain about 10% of what we read, 50 to 60% of what we see and hear. So after you leave, if you do nothing, you'll probably remember some of this, but we retain up to 90% of what we do, right? I couldn't teach you to ride a bike or to swim or to drive a car by explaining it. You'd have to actually do it. So we're going to be doing all of that. So I'm inviting you to get ready to play. And that's the other way we learn, is through play. The next principle is that lawyers are humans. And I'm not really being tongue-in-cheek about that, because what I mean by that is that we're subject to the same physiological and psychological phenomena as other human beings, but we don't work that way. We work as if we don't have feelings, as if our energy is endless. We work in ways that are not consistent or aligned with the way humans are designed. So two of the things that we're going to be doing today, like I said in the intro, we're going to be focusing on focus and feelings, and we'll be engaging so that you understand how the human experience, the human body is involved in this. And then thirdly, our physiology was designed to support us. We talk a lot about stress in law. Well, stress is not the enemy. Stress is a protective physiological function. The issue is that we don't know how to manage stress. We've voided our warranty. We buy a toaster or a computer and we get a manual, but humans don't get a manual as how to run their own systems. And so once you understand what stress is and how it works, it's not really an issue anymore. So we're not going to be talking too much about stress today, but you'll get some of that. We will get some stress management tools. You're going to have 5 tools today, but I'm going to take 1 minute to say, why listen to me, right? I was in your shoes and I needed tools and strategies for focus, for energy, for stress management, for supportive emotional and mental states. And so I went on a quest, and being very naturally curious, that quest never ended. So I studied social and emotional intelligence, have a background in biology. I did cancer research before I went to law school. And so I started to see how all of that was fitting together. And I created this blueprint that includes all of the elements of being human: social intelligence, emotional intelligence, intrinsic motivation, somatic intelligence, and cognitive intelligence, thinking, right? So lawyers, we need all of these things to practice, not just our thinking brain. And so coaching and training has become a labor of love for me. And I hope that the next 20 minutes or hour that we spend together are really going to help and support you. So why are we talking about this? And we all know that suffering is widespread in the legal profession. That's why California Lawyers Association has a health and wellness committee. And we've known for decades that the general population, the general legal population, suffers at rates of psychopathology at rates much higher than the general population. And why is that? Well, it turns out, we know this, that the decline in subjective well-being begins in law school. The research shows that students enter law school with the same amount of idealism and enthusiasm and optimism as other graduate schools, but that the decline begins in the middle of the first year and continues from there. And two of the primary reasons are the emphasis on linear thinking. We're all trained to analytical thinking, IRAC, and a disconnect from what matters to us most. Because when we're working on, when we go through law school and we're working on matters, nobody really cares what we think, right? It's really, what does the law say? So in the corner, I'm not going to cite my research, but I just wanted to point out this article in the corner is the article that got me on this quest, on this trend of why am I teaching and training and why I started teaching in law school because of this article and this research that legal education has an undermining effect on our well-being. So the good news is that it's preventable and reversible, and that's why we're all here. So let's dive in. Let's reverse this trend. Here we go. We've already said legal thinking is linear, and we know from the research that when it's applied broadly to our lives, it has detrimental psychological impacts. What we're going to focus on are the next 2 points, that practicing law is relational. And that doesn't mean the relationships that we build, you know, when we go out to develop business, there's that. But really what we mean by that, or what I mean by that, is the relationship we have with ourselves, the relationship we have to our work, the relationship that we have with all the people with whom we work, whether they're in the court system or in our office or our clients. There's an interaction there, and understanding what goes into that interaction is really, really important. Also, practicing law, nobody told us this, it requires energy, stamina, endurance, and resilience. That it was a surprise to me, maybe not a surprise to you, when I got out of law school, that there's a huge responsibility in practicing. We have a huge responsibility to our clients, and that takes a toll. So how do we build resilience? So these are the things that we also need training in. In a sense, I say that our education begins with our JD. It begins at graduation. So what's ahead? 5 tools. You're going to walk away with 5 immediately applicable tools for increasing your productivity, lowering stress, and supporting a sustainable high-performance practice. Quick EQ primer, what are we talking about here? Just so you know, and then we're going to get into our interactive part. So what is emotional intelligence? Well, first of all, it's self-awareness. What's happening with me in my experience right now? And am I accurately assessing that? Accurate self-assessment is really important. On the right, you see these are the reasons. These are the competencies. Behavioral self-control, stress management, resilience, et cetera. There are more than 30. This is just a handful that I chose because I think they're most relevant to legal professionals. And then we have other awareness, social intelligence. So when I'm interacting with my colleagues, when I'm interacting with clients, when I'm interacting with the court system, with whomever, what is my experience? What is their experience? Am I accurately assessing that? What's happening in the situation, and then there, the skills that go with that are interpersonal communication, listening, collaboration, trust, etc. So let's launch our first poll, if you will, please, Brianna. Thank you. So you're attending this program because, I'm going to put on my glasses for this. All right. So nobody's virtual lunch date canceled, and this is just the next best thing. Perfect. Thank you, 100%. We've got some more people coming in answering. Looking for skills to improve productivity. Good. We're going to talk about that. Excellent. All right. Looks like we're done. Okay. End the polling. And let's move on. So we had 88% said they were here for both, and 14% are looking for tools, focus skills to improve productivity. Let's do it. We're starting with focus. Here we go. Lawyer productivity. So there are 2 definitions. And by the first definition, by virtue of the first one, everybody in this virtual room is productive, because the first definition is the quality, state, or fact of being able to generate, create, enhance, or bring forth services. Everybody's is productive, not super yet necessarily. The question, the definition that I like to focus on is the effectiveness of effort. That's productivity. How effective is our effort? So let's get into our first game. And this is where you're going to need a pen and a paper or a pencil. and we're going to play a game called I'm an Awesome Attorney. Everybody ready for the game? Thumbs up if you're on camera. All right. So for the, there are two parts to this game. For the first part, pretty straightforward. You're going to write the words just as you see them on the screen. I'm an awesome attorney, and the number is 1 through 20 beneath it. When I say go, not yet, this is a timed, I got to get my little timer here. This is a timed game. And what I'll do, because I can't see most of you, what I'm going to do is I'm going to just count off like every 5 to 10 seconds. And when you're done, just mark your time. And then we'll do round two. It's going to have slightly different instructions. So if everybody's ready, when I say begin, please start. Ready, begin. Five. 10, 20, 25, 30, 35, and I'm going to stop there because I've never been in a room with attorneys or others who haven't been able to write, I'm an awesome attorney, the number is 1 through 20 in more than 35 seconds. So presumably everybody got that down and you got your two rows and it looks pretty much like what you see on the screen. Now we're gonna do round two, and round two is gonna be a little different. In round two, you're going to alternate letters and numbers. It helps if I get the instructions right. Although if you want to do it the other way, you can. So you're going to write I1, A2, M3, A4, N5. At the end, you want your end product to look exactly like your first one, but you're going about it a little differently. Any questions about that? Everybody clear on the instructions? Everybody has their cameras off. No? Okay. So you're going to write the letter I and beneath it the number 1, and then the letter A and beneath it the number 2, and then the letter M and beneath it the number 3. So that at the end of the day, even though you're alternating letters and numbers, you're still going to have the two rows. I'm an awesome attorney, and the numbers 1 through 20. So for all good, again, I'm going to start counting. I'll do it by tens, and just note your time when you're done. And then we're going to have a little discussion about what this game was about. So if you're ready, begin. Ten. 20. 30. 40. 50. 1 minute. I'm going to stop there because generally about most of you are probably done by now. So before we dive into outcomes here, what was that about? What did we just demonstrate? Anybody know?
Slowing down.
We demonstrated slowing down. Yes, that was your experience, is that you had to slow down when you did it the second time?
Exerting more effort to write in the same exact thing down.
It took more effort. Yes, it took more effort. So it was harder. It took more effort. And Sorry, Gabrielle, did I say that again?
Oh, more concentration.
More concentration. Okay, it took more concentration. Did anybody do it faster the second time? No. How much more time did it take? Usually it takes about twice as long, but at least 1.5 times. Is that the experience that most of you had? Maybe do a thumbs up or hit the chat. So actually I'm not looking at the chat, so you might have already. So any idea what phenomenon we were, let's see what the chat has. Yes, about double. Okay, thank you. Any mistakes, by the way? Mistakes, you can just shout it out. Yes, no? Usually there are mistakes. How about neatness? Did it look as good the second time as the first time? No. All right. So let's move on. Oh, I like your little emoji. What is with my, come on, not the time to get stuck. There we go. What we demonstrated, in fact, was multitasking. We are not designed, the human brain does not, in fact, multitask. What you were doing was switch tasking, and that is what our brain does when we are trying to do more than one cognitive task at a time, more than one thinking task at a time. Now, I would bet that 100% of the people in this room can relate to that photo, because that's what we're doing. We're working on emotion, and then the phone rings and we answer it, or maybe the phone doesn't ring and we pick it up. We're going to talk about that. So when the brain is switch tasking, it takes longer to complete the task we're ostensibly focused on, right? Ostensibly, I sat down to write my brief or write my document or whatever it was. But instead, I'm not just writing that document. I'm doing 14 other things as well. So it increases the amount of time it takes. It decreases our quality. It causes mistakes. It increases stress. So some of you said it was harder. You had to concentrate more. It actually increases the cortisol in our body, and it does create more stress. It shrinks our cognitive capacity, and it also drains our brain of resources, which is why at the end of the day, we feel fatigued, because we're using all of our brain's resources, nutrients, glucose, fat, oxygen, to do all of this extra work. This is taking a toll. That's why at the end of the day, most lawyers feel like a dish rag. So this is called continuous partial attention. It puts a ding in our productivity, and we are all inundated. We are inundated with tons of information, unlike anything we've experienced before. So it's going to be up to us to take charge of that, right? We are in charge. And if we don't take charge, this is where our attention is going. So it limits our ability to focus. It lowers our cognitive capacity and our intellectual capacity. So what's the solution? Yay, first tool. We're going to learn to focus. And we're going to do two attention training, focus training tools. So what's the first focus training? That the first thing you need to learn to do is to focus on one thing at a, excuse me, to do one thing at a time, to make the decision, identify a task. I am doing this task now. And essentially you're going to learn to kind of, it's like weightlifting. You're going to notice when you're distracted and bring your attention back. So kind of like lifting weights and building up that tricep or that bicep, you're building up your attention muscle. When you're distracted, you bring it back. When you're distracted, you bring it back. So how do we do this? Well, one of the first ways to do this is get yourself a timer. And you can use your phone timer, but if you do, you want to put it out of sight, because just the presence of a phone is a distraction. And I've proven this to myself and any other number of lawyers with whom I've worked. Just the device in the room is a distraction. I've picked it up multiple times without it ever even notifying me. So that's called self-interruption. Our brains self-interrupt, and we have to notice it to mitigate it. So you want to use a timer. I also have my other little show and tell timer. You could get a 30-minute one. And what the purpose of the timer is not for the time element. The purpose of the timer is to give you permission to do nothing else for that amount of time. So if you don't think that you can avoid your phone for more than 10 minutes, set your timer for 10 minutes and put it away and practice focusing for 10 minutes and increase that amount of time. So if you need to respond to an email, say it's a substantive email, it's a 20-minute email, turn off your other notifications, put your phone in a drawer. I stick my phone in a drawer and set a timer. And sometimes I actually use the phone timer. I can still hear it from the drawer, but I don't see it. And focus for 20 minutes and see how that goes. See if you're actually able to continue. And when your brain kind of goes off, come on back. Practice this and you will begin to actually increase that focus muscle. Do we have questions about that? Okay, let's continue. So mindfulness is a form of attention training. The definition of mindfulness is to pay attention on purpose, right? On purpose to the present moment, whatever task you're doing without judgment, basically, you know, not the way to overcome judgment is to add curiosity, but without getting into all the mental distractions that we have about how we feel about the work we're doing. And we'll actually talk about that in part two. So this part is to pay attention on purpose to what you're doing right now. So the next tool is how do we sustain our focus and energy? So now you've practiced and you're getting better, but how do you sustain it? How do you not end the day exhausted? What we need to understand are brain states and brain breaks. One thing I hear over and over and over again is I can't take a break. I don't have time. I feel guilty if I take a break or if I give myself a rest. And here's what we need to understand. And here's what I mentioned at the opening, that we've voided our warranty. We have voided our warranty because we don't understand how humans work. So understanding even a little bit about the human operating system helps us actually practice with greater energy and focus. So here's what's happening in your brain. I'm talking now. I'm in the predominant brain wave that I'm engaged with is beta, and I'm using my prefrontal cortex. It's the thinking cognitive part of the brain. There are no emotions there. It's my executive function. Because I'm engaged in talking and doing, that's where I'm at. Now, some of you are probably also predominantly in beta, but maybe in alpha because you're kind of chill, or maybe you're eating your lunch, or this is boring and you're zoning out. So you'd have a predominance of alpha. Now, why does this matter? Because a resting brain is not a stagnant brain, right? When we're resting, when I go and wash some dishes and I let my mind roam, that part of the brain is actively processing the information that I was learning or working on when I was focused. So when I'm in the focus state, writing that substantive email or drafting that motion or having that conference call, I'm using my cognitive brain. But when I go take that break to wash some dishes or get a snack or look out the window, it activates other neural networks. If I put that brain in an MRI machine, it's lighting up like crazy. So even though you feel like you're at rest, and I think we should probably come up with another term for that, even though we think we're not doing anything, we are. We are. Our brains are very, very active. This is why when you get in the shower, you remember things. You come up with solutions to problems. You have insights because the problem-solving part of your brain is now activated. So brain rest, resting the cognitive part of the brain, does not mean the whole brain is at rest. It means that the rest of the brain is activated. So it kind of alternates. These networks don't operate at the same time. They operate out of sync with each other. So if you're trying to figure something out, and I'm sure everybody in the room has had this experience, that you're sitting, actually, I'll tell you a real story. I had a student who was trying to write a note for his law review, and he was taking a position that was not supported by precedent. It was a controversial position. He knew he was right. He felt strongly about it, but he couldn't figure out how to make it work. And he's sitting at his computer, staring at his computer. Now, he was in my class and he knew a little bit about somatic intelligence. And he noticed that his whole body was turned away from his computer, in his words, as if to flee. So he's decided, you know what? I'm just going to get up and take a walk. His body was saying go. His brain was saying focus on this thing, but it wasn't working. He got up, he took a walk, figured it all out on his walk because his brain then was using movement and other parts of the brain that were not activated when he was trying to focus to figure it out and wrote the rest of his note. So it is very important for lawyers to get out of the habit of thinking that they're working if they're facing their computer. You are working when you take that walk. You are working when you gaze out the window. You are working when you're in the shower or washing dishes, whatever you're doing, right? So does that make sense? We're alternating between these diffuse and engaged states. So let's keep going because...
Can I ask a question?
Please.
Yeah, I've noticed that for me, and I've been practicing over 30 years, multitasking can almost feel to me like it's almost addicting because I feel like I'm accomplishing a lot and my brain feels like it's firing off in a bunch of different directions. And while I realize that it can distract from the focus that we sometimes need to have, is it really a bad thing? Or, and I may not be articulating this properly, but I there are moments or there are periods where I enjoy all the multitasking and I feel like I'm hitting on all cylinders.
Yeah. So what's happening is, so there's a little bit of a caveat, and that is that we can do a non-cognitive and a cognitive task at the same, at, you know, same time. You may be really good at switch tasking. So what you're doing, and this is the other piece of attention training, and you may have already trained yourself to do this, is that you're 100% focused on the thing that you're doing. You switch to the next one and you're 100% focused on that. You switch back and you're 100% focused. And so even though it feels like you may be doing all these different things in a short period of time, you've probably trained your focus to go 100% to whatever it is you're doing. So if you're doing that and you're doing it well, that's fine. The issue with multitasking is what happens to our energy. It's the increase in stress and the drain on our resources.
Sure.
So if we start to feel more stressed and we start to feel more exhausted, then you want to change something. But if what you're doing is actually working for you, if you're not feeling that energy drag, and if you're not feeling more stressed, then what you've probably done is gotten very good. And it's on the, actually on the previous slide. I'm not going to go back. But the part of attention training is if you take your entire focus and you move it to that other interruption or that other task and then bring it back, you're still focused. So does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Any other questions before I, let's move on. We have a lot to do. So let's do one more attention training. This is very quick, but one more attention training exercise, because this will give you a little bit of a sense of the nature of the mind. So take a moment, and if you want to close your eyes, you can, and if you don't want to, you can just gaze, look around. And I'm going to ask you to think about the last movie that you saw. What was the last movie that you saw? Where were you when you watched it? Were you in your room, in your bedroom? We're in a pandemic, so it's unlikely you were in a movie theater, but maybe you were with a family member. Were you with more family members? Were you alone? What was the genre of the film? Was it action adventure or comedy or horror? What was that like? So let's go back to the last movie you watched and place yourself there. And now let's leave that, our little home movie theater, and let's go pre-pandemic. And what was the last trip you took? Or maybe you were able or needed to take a trip during the pandemic. What was that like? Was it a business trip or a vacation? Was it with family, with friends? Was it fun or was it exhausting? Was it tropical? Was it within the US, international? So take yourself to the last trip that you took. Remember what it was like to be there. And now let's get back on the plane or into the car, come back into the room, into our virtual room here, and notice where you're sitting, the room around you. And here we are, we're back. So what did that demonstrate to any of you, if you have any idea, any thoughts on what we just did there?
It was relaxing.
It was relaxing. Yeah, it's nice to daydream. See, it is. It's good. It's good for our brains. So what we did there is it is natural for the mind to wander. This is what we do. When we were kids, we were told by the adults in the room, maybe parents or teachers, focus, pay attention, concentrate, but nobody ever told us how. And the way we learn to concentrate is by knowing how the mind works, and the mind naturally wanders. But here's what this exercise demonstrated. What this exercise demonstrated was that you're in charge. We're in charge of our brains, and we're in charge of where they go, and we're in charge of our thinking. So when we get distracted, we can come back. And so the more that we take charge of that experience, the more focused we can be without that drag on our energy, without that drag on our attention, without that drag on our resources. And I think that that's what David has gotten so good at over the years, is actually training himself to be able to do this kind of very focused attention and bring yourself back. So this is the last tool in this section. The formula for burnout-free high performance is focus followed by rest and recovery. Focus followed by rest and recovery. Remember that rest is not stagnant. That rest is problem solving. That rest is learning. That rest is memory. That rest is where the rest of your brain is activated and managing all of the stuff that happened when you were in cognitive focus. So fosters problem solving and breakthrough ideas. Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi writes about this in his book Flow. Probably most of you in the room are familiar with that. So here are some examples of non-cognitive breaks. Let's not call it rest, right? And social media and web surfing are not non-cognitive breaks. We're still engaged. It's exhausting. It's a draining. Well, that is how most people feel after scrolling. But I'll leave it up to you to decide and to know what is best for you. So questions before I go on to part two. We're all good. Okay. So what's mood got to do with it? Now you're focused, but you're still not getting all of your work done. What's going on? So we all know what mood is. It's what we feel. What am I in the mood for? What am I in the mood to eat? What am I in the mood to do? What am I not in the mood for? So if I'm not in the mood to do something, I don't do it. I kick that can down the road, right? I need to send out that document. Not in the mood, right? I need to review this, but I'm not in the mood. So the issue here, and this is something that we were not taught in law school and probably weren't taught in a lot of schools, is that how we feel influences our work. Right? Our mood and our mindset impact productivity and performance. So mood and motivation are non-cognitive influencers. They are at play all of the time, whether we're aware of them or not, right? Our emotions influence our decisions and our action or inaction, right? So I just identified procrastination. Let's kick that down the road. That has to do with how I feel. Antonio Damasio said it. We saw that at the beginning. Humans are neither thinking machines nor feeling machines. We are feeling machines that think. And Daniel Kahneman, who's a Nobel laureate, famously won the Nobel Prize for proving that we make important financial decisions emotionally, not rationally. We back it up with data, right? So if I hire a lawyer, I hire that lawyer because I trust that lawyer, because I like that lawyer, because there's something about that lawyer that makes me feel safe, secure, like it's the right decision. But then I use, oh, that lawyer won 10 cases like mine. That's the data I use to justify my emotional decision. So let's take a page from the athlete's playbook to see how this applies to lawyers and to lawyer work and to lawyer productivity. So an athlete knows that physical talent is just their threshold for entry. It's not the end, it's the beginning. So to perform at their best, they have to be in the right mood, the right mindset, and the right motivation. So if I'm an Olympic athlete and I'm at the top of that ski jump and I'm about to jump, you better believe that I'm making sure, right? And if you talk to athletes, they share this. They're listening to music that gets them pumped up, or they've gotten high fives from their teammates. They're doing all these things to pump themselves up so they're in the right mood, so that they're really feeling it. And if they're not feeling it, it impacts their performance. So the same is true for lawyers. Lawyers are cognitive athletes. We rely on our intellect to succeed, but our mood, how we feel, and our mindset and motivation, which is part of this, also influence our performance, right? Everybody with me here? So far, so good. So what do we do about it? We're gonna do some interaction here. So this is the mood meter from the Yale Center for Emotional Intelligence. And intuitively, you all know exactly what emotions go in each square. So there are two axes. We have high, we have energy on the left, and we have pleasantness on the bottom. So if I'm in the red zone and my energy is high, but my pleasantness is low, what emotions do I have there? And you can either just take off your mic and shout it out or put it in the chat.
Angry or frustrated?
Absolutely. Anger, frustration, absolutely. Anything else? We've got the chat. Let's see. Anger, stress. Yeah, anxiety, I think, would be the kind of stress that I would put into that square. So you've got it. Rage, fury, all that stuff. Let's move down into lower energy, but still we're on the low pleasantness side. Where are we here? What's happening? What do we got going on?
Depression.
Depression, yes. Depression. Impatience. That might be a little at the higher side. Irritable would be closer to the red zone. Sadness, yes. Sadness, lethargy, boredom, depression. Those are low energy and low pleasantness. Irritability and impatience are a little higher energy. They might be more along the line or in the low reds. Doom and gloom, absolutely. Let's not stay in the blue zone. Let's move over to the green zone. What's happening in the green zone? We're still chill, low energy, but our pleasantness meter has gone up. What's happening? Content, yes. Relaxed, yes. Yes, serene, exactly. These are the exact words. This is lovely too, because many lawyers have difficulty with actually emotional vocabulary, right? We lose our emotional vocabulary, so it's important to rebuild that. So focused, yes. All right, and focus is going to be a little higher on the scale. So let's go up into the yellow zone. What do we have in the yellow zone? High energy, high pleasantness. What's happening? What's going on? Joy, productive. Productive is a mindset. What's a feeling? Give me a feeling. Direct, confidence, yes, happy, invigorated, accomplished, kind. Kindness, I'd put kindness more at in the green zone, but it's up to you if you feel high energy from kindness, perfect. So exuberance, invigorated. All right, why does this matter? It matters because generally our work is only as good as we feel. Okay, come on. There we go. So our moods influence our work. And we talked about it before. If I'm not in the mood, I'm not going to do it. I have tons of examples on that, but I want to make sure we get through the rest of our tools. So the better we feel, the better we work. And again, knowing a little bit about our brains, we function optimally in a relaxed, slightly happy state. So if I'm cranky and I am not in the mood, that document that I produce is going to take longer and it just ain't going to be as good and it might have some mistakes in it. So we want to be able to shift into a more supportive mindset and mood. We want to be in a state of what's called realistic optimism. So not Pollyanna, everything is beautiful and the world is great, but what is a realistic, optimistic state of mind? The other piece to understand here is that we use our thoughts to shift our feelings. So once we've identified the feeling, so say I have a document to write and I'm feeling irritated and I know that's not useful for my document, the way I shift into a more realistic and optimistic and better mindset for that work is to use my thinking. We're going to do that exercise on the next slide. The last thing I want you to think about here is the task energizing or draining? So if that document is making me irritated, then that's probably draining. And I want to shift into thinking, how can I think about that document so that it's energizing? And I do have an example, but I'd rather hear from you all. So tool number 5, this is our final tool. And then we have a few other things, another poll. So, and then I want to leave a few minutes for questions. So let's take an example. There's an event or situation. You're in a mindset or in a mood that are not conducive to doing the work you need to do. So how do you move from that unsupportive state? And I like to think of emotions and thoughts as mental and emotional states. It's just a better way and a more measurable way of shifting. So what is the event or situation? What supports feeling crappy about it? What challenges that so you can make the shift? And what is the alternative supportive thinking that will shift you? So does anybody have a situation they want to throw out there? I can run you through one of my own so you get it. And then we can run through one with you if somebody wants to volunteer. So I had a situation a couple years ago. I'm on the board of a mental health organization that I love. And I suggested, it was right when it was in a startup and it was brand new. And I said, hey, we should apply for grants because there's lots of grant money out there. And they went, great idea. You are in charge of writing grants, which was not, I didn't think that was a great idea anymore. So they identified a grant and they sent it my way and said, please write and submit this grant. And it's a Sunday afternoon. It's pre-pandemic. It was a day like today, which is gorgeous in sunny Southern California. And I didn't want to do it. I was irritated. I was angry. I just wasn't in the mood. My body was just aching to get outside. And I sat on the sofa and I went, this isn't going to work. If I'm in this mood, this is going to take me all afternoon and it's probably going to be lousy. So what can I do? So what I did was I thought about, well, what if we got the $2 million? It was a $2 million grant. What if we got it? And I thought, wow, all of a sudden, almost immediately, my somatic experience shifted. I started to get excited. I felt butterflies in my stomach. I felt my heart expand. I felt excited. My brain started like thinking about all the things about this organization that make it worthy of $2 million. And so now I had shifted from the red zone into the green yellow zone. I was super excited. I had to kind of calm myself down, which believe me, once I got into the questions, it definitely brought me down a little bit. So I was more in the green zone, which is where I needed to be, top of the green zone. And I went from probably a -4, if we look at that scale, to a +2 or +3. So this is how we can use our resistance to doing something that we have to do and make it work for us so that it doesn't drain us and irritate us and make us feel worse and go out in poor shape, but we actually produce better at work, we do it more quickly, we do it with more energy, and we have a feeling of accomplishment when we're done, right? So does that make sense? And does anybody else have a situation they're grappling with that we can use? Any volunteers?
I just put one in the chat, Judith.
Sorry?
Oh, I just stuck one in the chat.
Oh.
So I was saying, I just switched gears and am job, but before writing a sentence in a memorandum for federal court where the sentence is very lengthy and you just kind of feel hopeless that there's nothing I can do or say to make the situation better.
Right. So what we would do, and I see somebody else also put one in here, and we'll see if we have time to get to both of them. So what is your unuseful? Let's just go through the steps here. And believe me, once you do it, you don't, the steps are very quick, but let's break it down. So what is your unuseful thought or experience? Just go ahead. You've stated it, but go ahead.
My unuseful thought is that I'm hopeless that I'm not gonna be able to do anything to make it better.
Okay. And so where are you on that scale from -5 to +5?
Probably -4.
Okay. All right. So that's, and is there a somatic experience associated with it? How do you feel when you feel hopeless?
Yeah. I mean, you just feel awful. It's draining, right? I mean, it just difficult to start the task as well, because you don't feel any energy behind it.
Right. Difficult. Very good observation. Difficult to start the task. And so the evidence that supports that thought, what makes you think that it's hopeless? You have to write this. Why would you even have to write this if it's hopeless?
It just, you know, you just get that coming from a perspective where even a good sentence is too much in your mind. A quote unquote.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's
okay. So even a good sentence is too much in your mind. What about the opposite? What thought or position or perspective could you take that would shift the way you feel about that? The challenge is this idea that any sentence is too much. What challenge is that?
It's hard. I guess maybe like the historical that I have done this before and I've gotten a good sentence, so I know it can happen, right? I mean, I know it can.
All right. Oh my God, that's a breakthrough. Yes. That's a breakthrough, doesn't it? Okay. How do you feel now? What's your emotion now?
Much better. I mean, I know it can be done.
You're not, sorry, if you're not hopeless, you're not fully hopeless.
Yeah, I'm not hopeless now. I mean, I know it. I have hope now. I know it can be done. I know, you know, good thing.
So, okay. So encouraged, would that be a possible, like you want to kind of think of an emotion that to tie it to, or you can just look at the numbers. Where are you now?
Probably now back at like a 3 positive.
So. Oh, big shift, -4 to +3. That's major. Sometimes I can barely get people to a 0 or +1. I mean, not me, but they, you know, people don't want to make that move. So good, good. So you're in a space where you actually can do this, right? Do you feel the difference in your body?
Yes.
Yeah. So what difference might it make if you were to kind of incorporate this process in general, just, and it doesn't have to be this like step. You kind of automatically go, oh, I'm not in the mood, feeling irritated. What do I need? Oh, I need to feel encouraged. Okay, boom. And you kind of get into that flow. So thank you. So we had one other dealing with my father's. Yeah, that's difficult. Can we come back to that? And I'm happy to work through it with you if we don't have time. I want to keep going through the slides, sure, if you don't mind.
Yep.
And great. Thanks. Thanks, Matt. Layla, wonderful. Yes, music is amazing. It really, really does. It does help. Oh, and you felt that shift too. Outstanding. Outstanding. So let's go to the next slide. So this is, we're starting to wrap up and we'll have one more poll. And then Matt, if we have time, we'll come back. So what does it mean to thrive in practice? Because a lot of people will say, oh, thriving is flourishing. That's the guy who's already successful and living at the top of the hill. But thriving is actually the progress we make. I'm thriving if I'm practicing and my practice is moving in the right direction, moving in the direction that I want it to move? And when it's not, what shifts do I need to make? So it's, we thrive when we have the mental and emotional ability to affirmatively meet the challenges of practice and emerge more resilient. Remember, we mentioned at the beginning that practicing law requires stamina, it requires energy. So these are things we need training to do, to learn, or it's going to exhaust us, which is what's happening, unfortunately, to a very high percentage of lawyers. And I will say that my personal mission and goal is to keep lawyers in practice and healthfully and happily in practice, not to have to quit, which is the alternative that a lot of people are heading toward. And then our capacity for thriving isn't fixed. We bolster it with emotional intelligence and resilience building tools. So again, these are all things we can learn. And emotional intelligence tools doesn't mean you're not already emotionally intelligent. You know, there are just lots of tools out there that all of us can add. So I'm a big fan of humor. So it's always sit, stay, heal, never think, innovate, be yourself. My hope is that this is where the practice of law is going, that we're going to move away from sit, stay, heal, and the way we've been training lawyers for the last 200 years, and start moving into human. How does the human mind work? How do humans innovate? How do humans practice? Because we are dealing with humans. Our clients are humans, first and foremost, right? We're the bridge. Lawyers are the bridge between the system of laws and rules and the messiness of human experience. And we're the ones who clean it up, right? So we have to make a shift in this thinking and in our approach. Never get so busy making a living that you forget to make a life. Maybe this is a good time to launch our second poll. So my takeaways. Oh, here, let me go to the next slide. Can I do that while the poll is up? Gives all the answers. All of the above. Thank you. A distracted brain is an anxious brain. Yes. All right. So it seems like most people good. Okay, good. Focus. Great. So those who answered took something away. Great. I meant to have, like, I always like to put a humorous one at the bottom, but I guess I couldn't come up with one. I saw something in the chat, so let's see if I can grab that. Can you distribute the cartoon? Yes, actually, here's my contact info, and anybody who wants the slides, I'm going to invite you. I will send you a PDF. So here's Judith at centerforthrivinginlaw.com, and shoot me an email. I'd be happy to share the deck, and you'll have the cartoon. And it's a New Yorker cartoon. They're copyright free or whatever. You're allowed to use them. And you could also find it on the New Yorker. So questions, what are the questions in the room?
Judith, can you just repeat that analogy that you just about the bridge and like we're the bridge? I love that.
Absolutely. So why do lawyers exist? Well, lawyers exist because society is kind of messy. Humans operate, we're driven by values. We're driven by our subjective experience. It's not a clear objective experience. And there's this innate net messiness, right? And so the legal system was created to find order, to find solutions. So it's very rigid. It's solution oriented. It's law, rule, regulation oriented. It doesn't take into account kind of the human messiness, right? So what's the role of the lawyer? The role of the lawyer, and in fact, if you go back historically, was as a healer. Lawyers were meant to heal. It's a healing profession, but it has shifted. And lawyers have become the tool of the laws and the rules of the regulations. And so the lawyers themselves have become rigid. What we need to do And this isn't true of everybody. I know that the lawyers in the room, you're all feeling wonderful, caring people, right? But that's where the stress arises, because you haven't had the training to align the two. So when we have the ability, the tools and the resources to align the human elements with the rules and regulations of law, then we're able to actually create the kind of healing in society that is intended. And I'm referring not just in, say, the criminal world or in the personal world, but also in the corporate world, right? Where we have to remember that even in the corporate world, we are dealing with humans and that there are people behind these businesses. So I think there needs to be more of a blending again. Then there are several movements to, and I'm going like this because they're called integrative law movements or restorative justice, which is a movement to include the community in the healing, because the law doesn't provide for that. The law doesn't provide a lot of the solutions that humans actually need, like an apology. You know, if you have a wrongful death case and somebody gets $1 million, but the family is grieving. They're grieving. They want to hear from the person that they're sorry. The money will never do that, right? So the law doesn't provide for that. So we have to find ways to blend the human experience and the legal world and bridge that gap. And we do that when lawyers are trained in tools and strategies, emotional intelligence, for communicating more effectively, and for practicing in a way that's more self-supporting. It's really, really important that lawyers remember it starts with them. And if they're not doing well, what we can offer to the world is compromised.
Thank you so much, Judith. I knew it was going to be excellent. You have such a good energy, and I know you're absolutely passionate about what you do, and it comes through. So I really appreciate you taking the time to do this presentation for us today.
Thank you. You're welcome. And please feel free to connect. All right. Take care and follow me on LinkedIn.